Penguin Audio presents Ariel by Stephen R. Boyett, read by Ramon de Ocampo.
Author's note: much has changed in the world since Ariel was first published in 1983. When I saw that Ariel was going to be reprinted, I thought about revising it to accommodate those changes. Then I realized that an important plot point and thematic element hinges on something that doesn't exist anymore. You'll know it when you hear it. Changing that would entail a fairly extensive revision, essentially making Ariel a different book. And changing everything but that would make it even more jarring. I feel that a released work is an implicit snapshot of its creator during its creation, a glimpse of where that person was in his craft and interests at that time. And even a fantasy novel, particularly this one, is an implicit portrait of the world in which it was created. So, in addition to the time-honored request of fantasy readers to suspend disbelief, Ariel also asks you to travel all of 26 years and leave behind a world that is much more crowded and has more cars, buildings, and freeways, along with cell phones, email, GPS, Wi-Fi, and all the rest of the electronic infrastructure that is now so deeply embedded that it is becoming invisible. Heck, even backpacks and camping gear are more sophisticated now. Stephen R. Boyett.
We fight rather to keep something alive than in the expectation that anything will triumph. T.S. Eliot. Chapter 1. I was bathing in a lake when I saw the unicorn. The water was cool and clear. The pollution had vanished years ago. I'm young, but I can remember the times before the change, when the filthy water would catch fire by itself. Now, though, I could leave my clothes next to my blowgun on the shore, grab a bar of Life Buoy, and wade on in. It was clean enough to fill my drinking flask from. I was scrubbing myself, enjoying the feel of slippery lather. It was a quiet day, as quiet as it ever gets, only the wind and the rustling of leaves, the accompanying insects. I usually sang when I bathed, to fill up the silence, but that day the silence was fitting and right, and I remained quiet. I had just scrubbed my face, and I ducked under to wash off the soap. When I came back up, I brushed wet hair from my eyes and spat out a sparkling stream of water. I shook my head rapidly and rubbed my eyes. There was a unicorn pawing at my clothes on the shore. I had seen unicorns before, fleetingly. They were shy, cautious creatures that usually bolted when they sensed me, like quick flashes of sunlight on metal. In the 5 years since the change, I had become used to seeing fairy tale things, living myths. But as I looked upon this creature, I knew I had seen nothing to compare to it for sheer beauty. I felt as if some cold fish had slid across my belly as I marveled in the cool water. It is an injustice to say merely that its coat was white. Oh, it was white, all right, but it was more than that. It was a white like I remember the best vanilla ice cream, but finer and smoother. Sometimes the sun hit it just right, and bright rainbow crescents fanned out like light through a fine spray of water. The hooves were mirror bright, platinum or silver, I couldn't tell. A distant lighthouse beacon on a lonely night, the spiral horn rose from the noble head, milky white, warm and welcoming. I can't say how long I watched it. Seconds, minutes, hours. Its tail swished randomly. Its nose was pressed against my backpack, but suddenly the majestic head lifted and it regarded me with two paralyzingly black eyes. Eyes full of life and intelligence. Eyes I could fall into. Lover's eyes. As it moved, the mane shimmered on its muscular neck like a road on a hot day. We looked at each other. Why did I suddenly have the feeling that I was the one who had no place in the world, that it was more real than I was? I was afraid to move, thinking I might frighten it away. Instead, I did the only thing I could think of to do. "Hello," I said, The silky ears pricked up, but otherwise it just stood there, reading my soul with those eyes. I began walking cautiously toward the shore. Fear flashed in its eyes, and I spoke to it in what I hoped was a reassuring voice. "It's all right," I said. "I won't hurt you, it's all right." I said this over and over again as I inched closer. Soon I emerged, naked and dripping from the water. I held out my hands. "Let's be friends." There was pain in the beautiful face, and my smile disappeared when I saw why. The right front leg was broken. Swollen and discolored, it was made even uglier because such a thing didn't belong on this perfect beast. No wonder it hadn't run away. "Oh, you poor thing," I said, kneeling. It backed away, half dragging the broken leg. "I want to help you," I said, and stood up. It looked straight at me. Its eyes were level with mine. "Woke," it said in a little girl voice. "I know. Here." I reached out slowly and stroked her shoulder. It felt like, I don't know, somewhere between cotton and silk. She flinched at the touch, but I stroked her mane until she relaxed. "Woke," she said again. "Yeah, it's broken. Pretty bad, too. I've got to find something to use as a splint so I can set it, okay?" "Okay," she agreed. I put on my pants and shoes and picked up the blowgun, then slid a handful of darts into a rear pocket. "Don't go away, all right? You'll hurt your leg even worse."
"Woke."
"Right." I smiled and darted out to the road, followed it about 50 yards until I came to a driveway leading to an abandoned house. I entered cautiously. I wasn't worried too much about squatters or vigilantes, but it never hurts to play it safe. I took a sheet from a musty bedroom, bundled it up, and walked into the garage. The car parked there was an old Volkswagen. The tires were flat and the windows were caked with dust. I picked up a rag from a workbench and wiped at the front windshield. There was a corpse sitting behind the wheel. It looked as if it had been there a long time. Years. There was a bottle beside it. The label read potassium cyanide in bright red, with a skull and crossbones beneath. I wondered why she, had done it. I shrugged. Suicide had never been a viable option to me. I liked life, crazy as it was. I turned around and picked up two long, thin boards from a small pile against the wall. The eerie feeling that the corpse was watching me made me feel like a dozen mice had skittered down my back. I hurried from the dead house and ran down the road. The unicorn was nuzzling my backpack when I arrived.
"No, get away from there," I told her firmly.
There were a couple of weapons in the pack, knives included, and I didn't want her nosing it open and cutting herself.
"Candy," she said.
"What?"
"Candy,"
she repeated plainly. "Sorry, little one, I don't have any." I trailed off and untied the pack flap to let her see.
Well, I'll be damned.
There was a small pack of peppermint candies nestled between a hunting knife and a foil packet of freeze-dried chili. I'd have sworn it hadn't been there before.
"Candy."
"Right." I fished out the packet. Brocks. 49 cents. Shaking my head slowly, I tore open the plastic, untwisted one of the red and white wrappers, and held the peppermint out in my palm. She took it gently with her mouth and crunched.
"Candy,"
she said again.
"Be good, and I'll give you candy after I fix your leg."
"Woke."
I made a splint from strips of the sheet and the two boards. It must have hurt like hell as I bound it tight, but she never flinched or made a sound. Thinking about Androcles and the lion, I stood up and gave her another piece of candy. I made a fire as it grew dark. Supper had been freeze-dried beef and rice and warm instant lemonade. She wouldn't eat anything I offered except peppermint candy. I washed my utensils after supper and leaned back against a palm tree. It was a nice night. October in Florida is always nice. It's the first lessening of the summer heat, and the first taste of winter is in your mouth. By day, the sky is a big blue bowl, and by night, it is pure as crystal, stars shining and crickets humming.
I lit a cigarette and looked up at that wonderful sky. After a minute, I noticed the unicorn was standing next to me, staring. "What's the matter with you?" I asked.
"Bad," she said in that innocent girl voice.
"Bad? What's bad?"
She lowered her head and, almost faster than I could see it, flicked the cigarette from between my fingers with her horn.
"Bad,"
she insisted. I started to protest, but stopped. Maybe the smoke bothered her. I shrugged and nodded.
"Okay, sure. Bad. Gotcha. Smoking, bad."
She nodded approvingly and turned away.
"Schmuck," I added.
She snorted. It sounded playful. I stood up, stretching. My cigarette was still burning on the ground. I stamped it out and got ready for bed. My sleeping bag was snugly warm. I lay in it, thinking, and from time to time I raised my head and looked at the pale form a few yards from me, silent and motionless. I smiled and rolled over onto my side. Eventually, I slept. I awoke next morning to find myself staring into lovely black eyes, snowman's eyes. She stood over me, lover's eyes regarding me patiently. The early morning sun caused an occasional pale orange glimmer on her left side.
"Well, good morning," I said, standing. "How's the leg?"
"Woke."
"Yeah, right. We're gonna have to teach you a few more words."
She watched me carefully as I buried last night's garbage.
"Feel like walking a little?" I asked her. "We'll take it slow and easy. There's a small town about 5 or 6 miles from here. I need some stuff."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.